Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, whatever time it is that you are joining us. Thank you for joining us for online worship at First United Methodist Church in Hanover, Pennsylvania. I'm Pastor Greg Rapp, Senior Pastor of First United Methodist Church, and it's good to have you. As we begin our worship, I want to ask a simple question, and that is, have you ever wondered what God looks like face to face? You know, in the Bible, we get told a lot of things about God, but we don't really ever get to look God in the face because God is so different. He's so high. He's so lifted up. He's so radiant that it is difficult, if not impossible, for we mere mortal human beings to see God face to face with our own eyes. Well, we're going to get a glimpse of that today. Our scripture story is the transfiguration, which is a big fancy word that basically means that Jesus will be changed right before our very eyes. Rather than seeing the heavenly, the earthly Jesus, we're going to get a glimpse of Jesus' heavenly reality today. And it's going to be amazing. So I'm glad that you are with us. God bless you. Let's worship.
Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
Gospel of Mark, chapter 9, verses 2 to 9. And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became radiant, intensely white, as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. And Peter said to Jesus, Rabbi, it is good that we are here. Let us make 3 tents, one for you, and one for Moses, and one for Elijah. And he did not know what to say, for they were terrified. And a cloud overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud. This is my beloved Son, listen to him. And suddenly, looking around, they no longer saw anyone with them but Jesus only. And as they were coming down the mountain, he charged them to tell no one what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
In the land of Oz, there was a wizard, great and powerful. Everyone in Oz had heard about the wizard, but no one had ever seen him. He lived far, far away in the Emerald City, at the end of the seemingly endless yellow brick road. Dorothy and her friends traveled the whole way to the Emerald City just to speak with him, because they needed his help. But when they arrived at the city gates, they were still not allowed to see him. He remained hidden behind smoke and fire and curtains and magic. No one ever saw the great and powerful Oz for what he really was. Well, later in the movie, during their last visit, though, the curtains accidentally fell open, just a crack. And it was enough to peek in to see that the wizard really wasn't all bluster and glory. They saw him for what he really was. And at first, Dorothy and her friends were disappointed at what they saw. They grew angry because they felt that they had been deceived. Because behind the curtain, he was just a frail, ordinary man, hiding behind the mystery. It was a sham. Well, I bring this up because God can seem pretty hidden and far away from us too, seated upon a golden throne in a heavenly city with streets of gold, hidden behind shrouds of mystery. Oh, he writes postcards to us through the scriptures, and that's nice. He talks to us over long-distance phone lines of prayer, and that's good. But reading a letter is not hearing a voice. Hearing a voice is not touching a hand. Sometimes it feels like God is hiding behind the very things that are supposed to reveal him to us. And sometimes we ask, why can't we just see God for what he really is, with our own eyes, face to face? So why all the mystery? What exactly is God hiding? We human beings do not like secrets. We don't trust secrets. We get suspicious. We long to strip away the clouds and the curtains and the mystery, and we want to see for ourselves. But what happens when we do? What happens when we join the disciples and journey upward toward the face of God? What happens when we reach the mountaintop and we peek through the curtain? Will we find more curtains? Or will we discover that God has taken a page out of the wizard's playbook, wrapping himself in mystery to keep us from seeing how frail and ordinary he really is? Will we be disappointed at what we find? Or will we be amazed? We have a burning need to know, and our burning curiosity draws us ever closer to God, like a moth drawn towards a flame. And we overhear the simple invitation from Jesus in Scripture this morning. Peter, James, John, come with me. I want to show you something. But his eyes say, shh, this is top secret. Don't tell a soul. This is for your eyes only. Now we, along with the rest of the disciples, we watch as they begin climbing further away from us. And our curiosity gets the better of us. Where are they going? What are they going to get to see, and why can't we come? We hate secrets, remember. We don't trust secrets because we want to see for ourselves. Hey guys, wait up, we shout. We're coming with. Jesus says nothing to us as we scramble up the loose stones after them. He doesn't seem to care or mind that we are tagging along. It's a good thing too, because we're far too curious to stay put. Well, as we climb, Jesus really seems so ordinary. He slips and he stumbles over the loose rocks, just like us. He grabs handfuls of grass and tree branches to pull himself up, just like us. He begins huffing and puffing from the strain. Sweat begins to trickle down his cheeks, and his knuckles bleed after scraping them against a rock, just like us. Jesus is so much like us. Born in a manger, raised in a carpenter shop. Well, at the top, we reach down and we pull James up the rest of the way, and then we all collapse in a heap at Jesus' feet, panting to catch our breath. And lying there with Peter and John and James, we feel Jesus before we see him. It begins as a tingle that makes the hair on our arms stand up. Do you ever feel that? It feels like sparks from a 4th of July sparkler falling on our skin, and the tingle begins to grow and move deeper inside of us, down through the layers of flesh, and the tingle sinks deep into our bones and shakes us like a rumbling earthquake. As if deep inside the center of our bones, God is playing the lowest note on a pipe organ, shaking us the way the pipe organ rattles the church windows. The rumble then radiates back out of us with the heat of a blast furnace. And as it grows, it feels like we're being torn apart. Confused, we turn and we look at Jesus. And we cannot believe our eyes because Jesus is glowing white. Now, it's not the soft glow of a child's glow-in-the-dark toy. You know, the kind that manages to hold on to a fading bit of light after the real light is gone. No, this is a powerful, dangerous light that burns the back of our eyes like a million flashbulbs or looking directly at the sun. And we shield our eyes and we try to blink away the blue-shaped Jesus flashes that remain. And we do not recognize Moses and Elijah who now stand beside Jesus, one on either side. Nor do we even know what to say. We're looking directly at Jesus, but we do not know what we see. Jesus, the real Jesus, is finally revealed to us. The curtain has been pulled back just enough to glimpse eternity, just enough to see God for what he really is. And we're not disappointed. We're terrified, but we're not disappointed. Peter is babbling something about building houses. He's just as frightened, as confused as the rest of us. We cannot think. We can only feel the panic of having the breath sucked right out of us. The pain of having our eyes blinded by the heat of a thousand suns. Our bones are rattled and shaken to pieces. This is what we've always wanted to see. This is what has been hidden from us for so long. This is the glory of Almighty God. And we can't stay here. The heat and the intensity are too much. It's going to destroy us. Our bones will quickly dissolve. Our skin will turn to ash. The holiness of God burns away all that is impure and imperfect, and that's us. Moses once asked God to see him face to face, and God said, "No, not because I have something to hide, but because I love you and I do not want to destroy you. I am, says the Lord, a holy and consuming fire. You must not come too close. No one can look upon the face of God and live." You see, the moth is drawn to the flame to give it warmth and light and direction, but the moth that flies too close to the flame is consumed. We're drawn toward the glory of God, but we cannot stay there in this mortal state. It's not safe. God is not safe. God is the raw, savage power of thunder that creates as well as destroys. God is untamed and untamable, like the burning surface of the sun. The sun is the center of our solar system, providing the light and the warmth to make things live and grow. But we must stay 91 million miles away from it, or it'll kill us. So it is with the brightness and the holiness of God. He is the center of our existence. His breath is our breath, the source of all life, and the light that brightens our understanding. But if we draw too close to God's pure majesty in this imperfect mortal state, we will melt away like wax. Yet despite the danger, God does not back away from us. God draws still nearer to us, enthroned in the temple, lighting up the Holy of Holies. He is a pillar of cloud by day and of fire by night. His feet touch the earth and he stands shimmering on the mountaintop, right in front of us. And he's moving yet closer, burrowing deep within us to claim our hearts and our souls as well. Our darkest secrets are pulled out into the open air like an exposed nerve. Our deepest sins break out upon us like a rash, visible. When the glory of God is revealed, nothing stays hidden, not even our deepest, darkest secrets. And still, Jesus moves closer. We cannot stand this much longer. It has only been a few seconds, just a few mere moments. The curtain has only opened a small crack, and yet we are brought to the brink of utter destruction by it. A few more seconds in this holy presence of God, and every atom of our being will come unglued, scattering us across the universe. The entire mountaintop will be scorched black from the intensity. God must know that we can't survive this. The only thing that saves us is God's infinite mercy, because he wraps the mountain in a thick cloak of mist and darkness, and it cools us like fresh ointment on sunburned skin. The fire of Christ is not extinguished, but it is cautiously hidden from us yet again. It's wrapped safely behind the heavy curtains to protect us. And Jesus looks ordinary again. God protects us from his overwhelming glory, but God refuses to retreat to a safer distance. Do you notice that? Because God knows that we need him here. We need him now. Amen? He keeps the glory here among us, but hidden just enough to protect us. We walk by faith and not by sight, says the Apostle Paul, trusting the unseen glory that is all around us. What we cannot view with our eyes, we can, however, experience and sense with our spirit. And there are unexpected times when the curtains open, just a crack, just a hair, and the light of God's glory is seen and felt and known. Not as pain and panic, but as comfort and strength and joy and warmth. Because God is with us. The curtain will not always be needed. We will become children of the light, holy and pure. We will see him face to face and not be destroyed. But this takes death and resurrection. It takes a cross and an empty tomb. It takes faith and trust in a holy God. And this is the work of Christ. This must happen. It also takes a journey of our own. We followed Christ up this mountain to see something unexpected. Now we follow him back down into the valley to live it out for ourselves, to become part of what God is doing in this world. With Jesus, we are headed to Jerusalem, toward a cross of our own, a death of our own, a resurrection of our own. Then, and only then, can we look upon the face of God and live. In a few days, we are going to celebrate Ash Wednesday together. We're not quite yet ready to open the doors and do it in person, face to face, but it will be available and we'll worship together next Wednesday, just as we're worshiping here online. But this story of Christ on the mountaintop and the evening of Ash Wednesday is the beginning of our 40-day journey that we call Lent. And Lent is a time to look ourselves in the mirror, not just how do we look and is my hair combed right, but to look in the mirror to see the inner things of us, to inspect our faith, our character, our sin, our gifts, and to take steps closer to Christ. We're going to be walking through the Sundays of Lent with Jesus side by side as he takes us, he turns his face towards Jerusalem, and he turns his face toward the cross. I hope that you will join us Wednesday, and I wish all of you, starting next weekend, a holy and a holy and productive and fruitful Lenten season. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we turn to a time of prayer, I want to share an announcement. This is a joy, and that is we are making progress as a community in the fight against COVID-19. Hospitalizations are dropping, vaccinations are starting to become a bit more available, and we have decided that we're going to be reopening our in-person worship in 2 weeks from today. That will be Sunday morning, February 28th, and we're going to be working on the same modified schedule that we had this past fall. That will be two services on Sunday morning in the sanctuary here at Frederick Street, and that will be at 8 o'clock a.m. and 9:30 a.m. I want to lead us into time of prayer, knowing that Ash Wednesday is just around the corner, and that this 40-day season of Lent is around the corner. Again, Lent is a tradition of the church, and originally it was a time of preparation for those newly found in Christ as they were preparing to take their vows, to give their lives to Jesus, to prepare for baptism. They took 40 days before Easter to search their hearts, to see what sins still were left unconfessed, to see where they have yet to surrender their life to Jesus Christ, and to begin to learn how to serve him, to learn how to pray, to learn how to struggle against temptations, and to come out on the right side of things. I'm going to be inviting you today, as well as on our Ash Wednesday service this coming week, but also next week, which is the first Sunday of Lent, to keep a holy Lent. And it is a time for you to ask yourself the question, how satisfied am I with my faith relationship with God and Jesus Christ? I'll ask you, and I want you to answer that. How satisfied are you with your faith relationship with God? The next question would be, how satisfied is God? Because we know that with God, there is always a next step to take. There's always another sin to confess. There is always another step. There's always more growth. There's more holiness. There's more prayer. There's always something that God can do to shape us and to use us for the building of this coming kingdom. So I want to invite you into a time of holiness this Lent. And I'm going to begin by praying a prayer for Lent. Let us pray. Loving God, as the days get longer, as the daylight gets longer, and the earth spends longer in the light of day, grant that we may spend longer in the light of your presence. And may those seeds of your holy word, which have been long buried within us, grow like everything around us into love for you and love for people, to become a visible declaration of your lordship in our lives. Grant, Father, that this Lent there may be springtime for our lives in Christ. We thank you, Lord, for Dick Williams, who wrote that prayer. And we want to thank you, Lord, that everything that we have prayed in this prayer is possible. That we are praying according to your heart, your desire, and your will. Forgive us of our sins, O God, for they are many. Shape our character, change our desires, that we might be content with your glory, that we might be happy with obedience, that we might feel settled and at peace with simplicity, that we might be at home in silence. And that in that silence, we might hear the still small voice of our God. Lord God, not only are we beginning the 40-day journey toward the cross, the death and resurrection of Christ, it's not just a 40-day journey of spiritual renewal, but our congregation, First United Methodist Church of Hanover, is in a time of transition. And we want to pray for your blessing, your protection, and your guidance upon us until the unknown becomes known. As I prepare, Lord, to say goodbye to First United Methodist Church and say hello to my new assignment at Park Church Cowdersport and Faith United Methodist Church in Sweden Valley, we want to pray also that you will guide our bishop and cabinet for the selection of the new senior pastor of First United Methodist Church, Hanover, that you have chosen. Despite all the challenges that we face, a change in our culture, a bitterness and divide in our politics, a slowdown in our economy through COVID, and a separation because of social distancing, we pray, Lord, for the day in the near future when not only can we reopen two services, but that we can reopen our society, our church, our ministries fully. We want to pray for our Staff Parish Relations Committee, who is tasked not only with assisting the bishop in the discernment of a new senior pastor, but also, Lord, they are in discernment over the future of our staff, as we have several positions that are open and need to be filled, and we would like your guidance, O God, in what is the best way. We cannot answer these questions as a congregation without knowing first your desire for us as a church family. We know, Lord, you have more for us at First United Methodist Church than to just get through each day. We know, Lord, that your desire is to use this and every church to reach into the neighborhood and to share Christ with our neighbors. And only when the God of second chances is known and loved and embraced in every heart, in every household, in our community, will the kingdom of God really become real for us. So we pray as a congregation, Lord, the prayer of Jesus when he said, "Not our will be done, but yours." So expand our imagination, give us a sense of your future. Because we trust and we know, Lord, because, as said a moment ago, we walk by faith and not by sight. We know that your church is more than what we are right now. And so we pray for your next season among us. We pray for that next new pastor. We pray for the reopening of our community and our congregation. And we pray, Lord, for what you are about to do to change us and our community. All of this we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who taught us how to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. I want to continue to thank you for the ways in which you are financially supporting the ministries of First United Methodist Church. If you have never stepped foot in one of our campuses, but you have met us and have worshiped God online, if you have also never taken the opportunity to give financially, we just want to let you know that there are some easy ways for you to do that right from home. This goes for everybody if you haven't given in a while because you haven't been present. You can give remotely the old-fashioned way by writing a check and putting it in the envelope and sending it through the U.S. mail to First United Methodist Church of Hanover. It's 200 Frederick Street, Hanover, Pennsylvania, 17331. Or you can call into the church office Monday through Friday, and you can ask to talk to Holly DiFilippo. Holly is our financial secretary, and she can help you set up electronic giving, where you can schedule your gift to go automatically from your bank to the church's bank. There's some paperwork that Holly will help you fill out for that, but that's very, very convenient, and it's a great blessing to the church as well. And finally, if you are online savvy, and if you're worshiping with us here, I suggest you might be, you can go to our church website, click on the Giving tab at the top of the page, and using what's known as Easy Tithe, you can make a gift using a personal debit or a credit card right online. You can schedule that to be recurring, or you can just make a one-time gift. However you choose to give to First Church, know that you are giving to God first, and we thank you for trusting us to serve God with your gift. I want to pray over your gift and your giving right now. Loving Lord, we offer to you these gifts from our heart. And we ask as always, Lord, that you will accept and bless each gift as you accept and bless each giver, dedicating all toward the completion of your kingdom, heaven on earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And thank you.
Turn your ear to heaven and hear the noise inside. Sound of angels, oh, sound of angels' songs, and all this for a king. We could join and sing. Offer Christ the King. How constant, how divine, this song of ours will rise. Oh, how constant, how divine, this love of ours will rise. Will rise. Joy.
thank you for joining us in worship today. I pray and I hope that God has spoken to you by His Spirit in some way, and that you are already beginning to think about how you want to spend the 40 days of Lent. What do you want to see God do in your life? What part of your faith or discipleship would you like to work on, focus on? What needs God's healing touch? Not only that, but I completely forgot to share something that Deb, in our children's message, shared a moment ago, and that is also not just a happy and blessed Sunday to you, but happy Valentine's Day, which is a day of love and companionship, and I hope that you find a wonderful day somehow to enjoy this day safely during COVID-19. And remember, on Valentine's Day, God loves you more than any human word can describe. So with that, I bless you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, as we go in peace. Our next service online is going to be this Wednesday evening. It will be our Ash Wednesday service. And otherwise, we'll see you back here next Sunday, and again on the 28th. For those that are ready to come back in person, we will be reopening the Frederick Street campus for in-person worship. Have a great week, everybody. God bless you.